everyone, welcome back to this YouTube channel, The Immigration Gurus. This is Jitendra Grover, Research Scholar, ETS, Montreal, Canada. Today, finally, we got appointment from Karan Singh. Karan recently got his AIP after 9 years of experience, almost 9 years of experience. He was in IT field and he went for project management program in Algoma University. Yes, 2 year program. Also, he was my classmate during UG time. We did BTech together, Computer Science and Engineering, 2011 pass out. So he was my classmate and we are close friends. And he was the first case I dealt with this much of experience. So professionally, I dealt with the case. So I started on the highest level. That's 8-9 years of experience, not the fresh cases. Humne start upar se kiya hai. So he recently got AIP on September 3rd, on his birthday, I guess. Yes? Yeah. Okay. So let me share a bit of his background and he will explain his background and his experience. Let me share all those things. So this is his AIP he recently received. Few details are hidden. So application number and all those things. And he is having the permission to attend classes online. We are going to discuss those things later on. And this is his CV that we submitted with the application. Few personal details are hidden. Karan, would you please explain your experience, whatever it is, and how we went with all those things.
Hi everyone. So my name is Karan and I did BTech in 2011. So as Jitendra told, we both were classmates. So post that, since March 2012, I have been working in IT as a software engineer. So I have almost 9 years of experience now. So in March, I will be completing 9 years. So in this 9 years, I've been working with various MNCs in Bangalore, and I even have an exposure of client side, that is Ireland, Dublin, for almost 2 years. So with this journey, I have worked with various technologies and various platforms as well. So as you can see, the CV is quite elaborated one. So recently I got AIP and I have taken admission in a graduate certificate in project management, Brampton campus.
So we submitted this detailed CV to show that the guy has experience. It is just not to mention, but he has worked on these many projects. And the real thing was to make sure that he is going to a program which is going to give him career growth after the completion of the program. So there are two things which are interrelated. So one thing is prospect of returning back. Second, the program must be in line that is going to give career growth. And both are interrelated. How they are interrelated? I have explained this thing in one of the other videos where I explained how to make your SOP when you are applying with experience. I followed the same practices, all the things same for Karan and for other cases as well. So I mention all those things, whatever I practice, not just to make videos, but I practice the same things as well. We showed that Karan wants to become a project manager in his company and he wants to come back, join his company in India. So there are two things interrelated. This is a prospect of returning back that he wants to come back to India to join the same company. Plus, he is going to have a career growth in the company. And we also mentioned that even though he is unable to join the same company, he can also go to other company and join as project manager. So it is just like the direct growth in his career. So that was the plan behind the entire thing. It worked and there was no requirement of actually making a fake profile or something that many people actually want to do, many consultants want to do. I don't want to go for all those things because that may directly lead to misrepresentation for 5 years, ban in almost all the countries whosoever are linked. So 5 countries are linked. If you get a ban with your fake profiles, so Australia, Canada, New Zealand, UK, and USA. So 5 eyes in the world. So they share their data in between. So that's why I am never interested in making fake profiles to send people for study, because ban will be on you, not on me. So it is never preferred by me. So I don't go for those type of things in my consultancy. That is never preferred. So we went with the original profile. That was the plan. We wanted to show him a bona fide student. We showed it and he got the AIP. So now he is 1/4 Canadian.
Giving a background, my background related to this, so it was quite relevant for me for opening this particular project. The reason behind that is I've been working as a software test engineer. So what this particular project management program is very relevant to my profile. So down the line, if I would have been continued working same, this would have been the same profile where I would end up my career. So it's the same thing. So this was quite relevant to me.
Many people with experience ask me why not to go for a technical profile. So I am a bit reluctant in going with the technical profiles after technical programs after the technical profiles, because when you ask about when you want to show your career growth, so you want to become on managerial side, you want to have that kind of growth. Yes, I am not saying that no one is going to get visa if you go with the technical technical program after your technical profile when you have experience more than 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, 8 years. But the problem here is to show some serious growth in your profile. That happens when you get some managerial profile above your rank. So that's why something in management is really relevant. That's why it makes me go towards project management or some masters in project management. So any PG level program or even the masters. So any PG level program can work. But again, I don't want to send people for generic MBAs, because for someone who wants to have a particular career growth, is targeting particular career path or particular position above him or her. In that case, project management is pretty relevant. It's pretty specific. So that's why I prefer this program whenever whosoever is coming with some experience. So rather than generic MBA, it makes more sense to me. Plus, whosoever has already done masters earlier, going for another MBA, same, has done MBA earlier, going for another MBA doesn't make any sense. So that's why I am pretty choosy about what programs a person should go for. It requires so much of, it may look like we can go for anything, any masters or anything, but choosing the program is the first crucial step to go towards study visa. If that step is wrong, entire application is gone. So that is one thing. Always go for a relevant inline program that is going to give you career growth that you can specify. And also in SOP, you cannot be really generic. I want to do this, that, da, 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 da. Your application will have 1 minute to show your bona fide studentship and all the things. If you are unable to show it crisply with all the proofs, with your particular career path, career growth, so if you are unable to show all those things, it is going to be rejected for sure. So it must be really crisp. So whenever I write, I do it means in a way where I remove all the things, whatever I can remove. So I want to write less. I want to write crisply. I don't write essays, and I charge for writing less rather than writing more. So people ask me, just for writing SOPs, you are saying that you are going to charge some amount or something. I am not really interested in writing only SOPs. I am interested in managing the entire cases from beginning to end. And I am not an SOP writer, because people say that just to write two pages, you may charge some random amounts. So I am not an SOP writer and I am not really interested in doing those things. I am interested in managing the complete profiles, and people ask me to just to write SOPs. I am not really interested in those things. I'm really serious about it. I might be doing it for a few people who are in kind of a stuck situation. No one is helping. So that is my nature, that I want to help people, but doesn't mean that you can consider me as an SOP writer. And later on, you can say that just to write two pages, you want to charge some amount. So I don't want to go to that path, and don't want to listen to those things as well. Just because this is the most crucial thing, and it is going to get you visa. People may think, may not think, because all the essential documents anyone can attach. Anyone can fill those Google forms, forms like Google forms, and they can submit. That is not the crucial thing. Crucial thing is SOP whenever you are applying with experience. So what was your experience when we were creating SOP? How many days it took?
For me, it was really a tough time. The reason behind that is I was not sure what exactly need to be presented. So as you suggested, I kept on providing you details of every aspect, either it's educational documents, my work experience document, financial documents. So I remember that I had to scan a particular document for more than some 10 times. The reason behind that was a clarity, the end-to-end document which need to be provided. And yes, it was quite a tough job. It seems and looks very easy. Okay, only education documents. Okay, fine, I will go and get it done. But when we want to provide it as per the SOP, so it has to be in a particular way, manner. The attachment has to be in a particular format. So that is, I think, the toughest part. Moreover, having an idea of how to provide a financial documents that really needs a good amount of knowledge. Yes, the reason behind that is a single document, a single mistake, you can end up in getting rejection. So I think SOP is one of the major document which decides everything. If your SOP is correct, you will get a acceptance. If there is a single mistake in that, definitely you're going to get a rejection. So for me, getting a guideline, I think it was quite tough. So though it was, I provided everything, but yes, collecting documents, getting everything done, it took a lot of time. So I think for me, it took almost some 10 days for starting to end, for getting everything done.
Yeah, for those 10 days, his SOP was open in my laptop until unless it got finished, and I gave it to Dhiraj for final submission of documents. So only one document took 10 days. All the other documents just took, I guess, 2-3 hours in completing.
Exactly. Yeah.
We sat together, we saw all the details and all the immigration forms, uploading everything. It just took 2-3 hours. Just creating the SOP took 10 days. And the maximum document size that we can upload is 4 MB, just 4 MB. And there were 76 pages in one PDF in his SOP. So mostly my SOPs, yeah, with experience, they are 50, 60, 70 pages. Or in his case, it was 76 pages. So managing all those documents, if someone is there from computer science background, they must be knowing in 4 MB, 76 documents, 76 pages, and they must be clearly visible as well. You cannot just upload anything which is not visible, and managing them in line. So writing everything, then managing all those documents, attaching all those things in line, and what you need to submit, what you need not to submit, what to write, what not to write. Every single crucial detail is really important. Only one word can lead to rejection. Just mentioning that you had 46% in your graduation degree. Yes, you are submitting document, the visa officer can see it. But when you are writing that you had 46% in your graduation degree, it may lead to rejection, that you are incapable. You cannot write anything negative in your SOP. Everything must be pretty clear, crisp, and there cannot be anything negative. You cannot mention that you had few rejections there, and you want to counter them in your SOP. I have seen so many SOPs where the guy starts with, I had this and this rejections, and these were the reasons. I want to counter these reasons. You are starting with a negative thing. Why you want to show all those things? You want to write all those things anyway, but don't write that you had rejection. If someone wants to see the rejection history, you have already given it in the immigration forms. If visa officer can go and see, that's fine. But why you want to mention those negative things in your SOP? I will never do it. So my way of doing it is nothing negative in the SOP, only positive things. If I need to skip anything in to do those things, I will skip those things rather than mentioning a negative thing. So this is my way of doing. We did it for Karan as well, and we got half success. Half success means I said that he is 1/4 Canadian because he just got the AIP. Second stage visa is still pending. Fingers crossed. Hopefully he will get his full visa. And after some time he will get his PR as well, then he will become complete Canadian. Yeah, so we want to meet him in Canada. Okay, how is your classes online experience? Because you have started your online classes, you are working as well. That's why we were unable to catch him because he is managing both things. And today on Sunday he was a bit free, so today we wanted to have a meeting. So how is your experience with doing work from home plus managing your online classes? So how is it going, if you want to show all those things?
So as everybody know that in pandemic time, it's been declared like people will be working from home, and from me as well. So it was declared since 4 months, and recently I got my AIP and my classes started on 8th of September. So it's been almost 2 weeks now, so that I've been attending classes. So it's okay, it's manageable. So for this particular semester, what they have declared is like it will be online classes. So what they have done is they have provided us few online portals where we can log in and we can have our classes. They have given us a timetable, the entire sheet of till December. So when and which lecture will be delivered and how it will be delivered. So there are two formats. One is online session and the other one is offline. In online, it will be delivered directly and where we can just, it will be a live lecture where we can have our question answers as well. And in offline, they upload a lecture where we need to go through those videos, assignments, PPTs, and there are various quiz which they conduct every week. And there are a few assignments which they are providing us that need to be completed on time. So Jitna, shall I go ahead and show you how it is happening?
Yeah, if you can, yeah, it will be great. So how is it going? How the online classes are going on? So if you can show, it will be great.
So let me know once it's visible for you.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay. So this is my Algoma University login. So as you can see, my name is there and this is Algoma University portal. And once if I go to my summary page, you can see my name and my advisor name. So in case if I'm facing any kind of support or in terms of my subjects or any academic related queries, I can just directly get in touch with this person. And as you can see, there are total five subjects which are assigned to me. So being into project management, we were offered 6 streams out of which we need to select one, as being getting specialization in that. So being into IIT guy, I have selected information technology, and you can see there is one subject which has been added over here, and the rest other 4 remain same for every person. And here is the LMS. LMS is a learning model system. The way lectures will be delivered, either it will be a live lecture or it will be a offline lecture. So as Brightspace is not yet available, so I will show you Moodle. So this is our Moodle portal. And this is the UI, which is in front of you. And you can see that these are the various subjects which I was talking about and which are assigned to me. And you can see there are a few assignments which were given to us, lectures which were delivered, and it shows like what percent that particular subject has been given to us and I have covered those things.
Let's discuss how you are managing these online and classes and job together. Aur kuch discuss karna hai kya?
So let me give you a brief about how lectures are delivered. So they are delivered in two formats. One is online and other one is offline, which they call as a synchronous and asynchronous. So a synchronous method is where a professor comes live and he gives lectures. And so everybody is a participant, and if in case we have any questions, we can directly ask him. And if we have any doubts, we can get it clarified. And that is more of one-to-one session which happens. So asynchronous is something like there will be a timetable which will be given to us and a lecture will be uploaded in this LMS system where any time which is feasible to us, we can go there and just go across the records are uploaded, and there might be some assignments which we need to take it up. So for me, it's like 4 days a week there I have sessions, of which 2 days it's live sessions and 2 days it's offline sessions. So as we know, in this pandemic we cannot travel to Canada. So right now what they have done is it's an online session, which I'm not sure about how it's going to be in future, if the same model will be continued or not. So that is, I think, we'll come to know once we get some clarity on one of travel. And so talking in terms like how I'm managing is like, it's not that hectic. So as my office starts by 9 and it's end up by 7, and mostly my classes are in midnight. Two days it's, the classes are from 12 a.m. to 2:30 a.m. That is early morning. So I have to attend those live lectures as they have marks of attendance, and so those are something compulsory for everybody. Apart from that, the other 2 days it's an offline lectures. Whenever I get time, I go through those lectures. I try to make my own notes. So the uploaded stuff is like they are live recorded sessions. PPTs are there. Some reading content is there. So the lecture is delivered in that format. So it's quite manageable. I'm not facing such kind of issues.
But you are working here and you are managing this lecture. So it is like you are doing both the things. Even though there is bit difficulty in managing those things, it is fine because you are running as well. So it is.
Yeah, that thing has to be managed. Yeah,
that thing has to be managed. So one more thing I would like to mention, that whatever Karan is attending right now, all those things, all those proofs of his registration and everything, we have uploaded those things. We have sent it to IRCC Delhi. As they may impact his second stage visa, and we are kind of feeling that we want to send a message that Karan is attending classes online. He is a bona fide student, so we want to make sure that he has got first level visa, that is AIP. He should get second level as well, otherwise everything will be wasted. So Algoma University has a policy that they are going to refund if the visa on second stage is rejected. So they are going to deduct $300 and they are going to refund the rest of the fee. So there is, it is kind of a win-win situation. We are not losing much on it. So it's better to attend classes online. And we hope that with this, it is going to make a positive impact that the guy is a bona fide student. When he got the permission to attend classes online, he is attending classes online. So that was the whole thought process, and we have submitted all the proofs yesterday or day before yesterday, I guess, or whenever you gave it to me. So we want to make it sure that he is a bona fide student and he is attending classes. So hopefully VFS offices, they are going to open soon, and you get your visa stamped as well, and all the other formalities whatever are pending, they will be completed as well. Thank you so much for joining, Karan, and we hope you good luck wishes for this journey, and hope you get the second stage visa as well. You are a hope for everyone, that people with experience can also get visa. One thing again I want to say, I have said it so many times, intelligence and knowledge are different things when you are applying for study visa. So with experience, yes, you have a ton of experience, you have ton of intelligence, yes, that is there, but knowledge how to apply even the small mistakes can be really crucial. It is not really a light process and you can just go and apply and whatever you want to show in SOP, you can write and all those things. Everything is crucial from applying for the program, choosing the program, applying for the program, getting everything done. Every single document in SOP, visa officer may see it, may not see it, but we need to present those things. So you need to make your file heavy, correct, crisp, everything. So it must be really, really clear that this is your thought process, this is your idea of, about your career, and this is what you want to do, and these are your prospects of returning home. So hopefully this is going to motivate a few people and who are having experience, unable to go to Canada through express entry or PNP, got stuck here and still can go for study visa. So if you can afford some 15-16 lakh upfront is the cost. Yes, you need to do $27,000 approximately. Out of which $10,000 is that is your savings in Canada as GIC. So you can use that later on for the next year fee that is there. Karan will not be able to have that amount in hand as of now, because until unless you reach Canada, you cannot use that amount. So you are going to access that amount whenever you are going to reach Canada. And those are the expenses of you going to Canada and staying there. So right now, as he cannot go, he cannot access that amount. So for next year,
I'm trying to share one experience over here. So initially I thought like it's going to be very easy, just about uploading a document or just writing an SOP. But when he started it, I realized like, yes, we need an expert advice in that. Even we cannot have a particular document which is even it's cut on its edges or providing a particular information that has to be accurate and true. So this is something which we need to take care. So yeah, we need an advice.
I also received so many inquiries. Someone actually offended me with a few words that all the consultants are scammers and all. I want to change this perception, yes, but I don't want to listen someone saying something about something like this about me. So I just want to change this whole perception. Everyone is not a scammer and with some common sense knowledge. So my way of doing is I want to upgrade my knowledge that to give you best services again. So these type of knowledge, expert advice, and all those things are always required. If I say this to people, they think that I want to push them towards me when they can do it with anyone else. Yes, everyone claims that they are good, they are great. But again, many consultants who are really established, even they don't write their SOPs. They ask you to write your SOP with your intelligence. You believe that. And you are bound to believe that you have enough knowledge and you can get everything done by yourself. When I say it to people, you require some expert advice, go with me or go with anyone else, but go with some expert. So they think that we are pushing them towards consultants, which they are never wanting to go towards or they are not interested in. But again, you need to find the right person who can do these things for you. Until unless that guy is not there, if you feel so, I believe that one person out of 10 or maybe 20 can do it by himself or herself. Rest, even a single mistake can lead to rejection. I am not saying that if I am applying or if I am doing everything correct, it is going to be an acceptance for sure. After 4 or 5 years of experience, there is no guarantee of any visa. And even there is no guarantee of any visa with the fresh cases as well. I don't give any guarantee whatsoever. I never said these words. This is a sure shot. This is 100%. There is a guarantee. You will get visa. Aapka toh ho hi jayega. I never said these words. There is no guarantee. Even my PhD visa got rejected and I had to fight it and got it. So I didn't require to apply again. I got it without reapplying, but my PhD visa was also rejected. So if PhD visa can be rejected, any visa can be rejected. So that is my thought process. So there is no guarantee at all. I won't give any guarantee. But my try is to give our best shot. Rest, leave it to our visa officer. Rest, leave it to your luck. But we should be foolproof when we are submitting application. So that is my way of doing. That is my try to submit your application. So thank you so much, Karan, for joining. Thank you so much for this session. I wish you luck again, and hopefully you get the second stage visa. We have submitted your documents, whatever you are attending your classes. So hopefully it will make an impact, and your second stage visa will be smoother. So thank you so much for joining again. I hope this video will be useful for many who are applying for applying with experience or got stuck for their Canadian dream. This is one path of going, and you can also take this path with careful submission of your application and careful choice of your program. Thank you so much for watching. If you need any advice, you can ping me on the mobile number. It must be there in the description. You can find it. If you you can also watch other videos which are related to this SOP, how to get visa with study visa with experience. There is some video like that, and you can watch those videos as well. Hopefully they will be useful for you guys. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for joining. See you in next video.